the topic for today is strategies that you can use to get back into training after the pandemic. So for you guys, we're going to have planned things for you, because Siki, for the viewers watching this that don't know, Siki is in the TPS Method program, Training for Life. And Brian is one of our online clients, also trains in the gym with us on tpsmethod.com for powerlifting. So Brian has a program right now on the site that we wrote, and it's called the Pandemic at Home Block. And it's based on people that have access to a minimalist home gym, basically a power rack, a bar, a bench, and some limited equipment like bands and maybe some dumbbells and things like that. So they're working on volume, and they're working basically off an RPE, because a lot of people don't have enough weights at home in the current situation, which is not Brian's situation. He's got plenty of weight, so he can work where he needs to work. But in the at-home workout, we're having people work to an RPE, because you know, you might have a 700-pound squatter on the program that only has 300 pounds of weight. So we have to change that to give them a training effect, and we do that with tempos and things like that. So for Brian, it's gonna be easy for him to return to full training, because we're gonna write a block that meets the guidelines that we're going to talk about today to ease people back into training and get them up to speed quickly. The Siki is going to be also easy for him to do, because we're going to write his program as well. But we have to take into account, when we're putting people back in the gym and back on programs when this lockdown is lifted, that they may A, have had access to weights and been training, or B, have not had access to weights and have either been not training at all or been doing body weight only. So not training at all is going to be the lowest common denominator, and we're going to have to accommodate for that, because it's a group program. So the guidelines I'm going to list will be helpful for anybody in this situation. So I'm going to go first with the people that have not been exercising. So if you haven't been exercising at all, and you were lifting weights on a regular basis at a moderately high intensity to a high intensity, it's probably going to be a very good idea to take an extended introduction back into the gym, no different than when you first started training, if you trained with a qualified coach. You know, if you train with a coach and you come from a background of no lifting, we're not going to, you know, give you weights right away. We're going to make sure you can handle your body weight and adjust the intensity and the volume and, you know, the frequency and things like that up a little bit higher over the course of many weeks. And the reason is your muscles and your connective tissue have different levels of strength than a detrained person, right? So if somebody that doesn't lift weights starts to lift weights that they, you know, maybe could handle mentally and even maybe physically, and they're higher weights, that's got a high potential to lead into long-term injuries with the connective tissue. So what we want to do is make sure that we build that connective tissue back up, get your body acclimated to lifting weights. So people that have not been strength training during the pandemic, what we want to do is slowly reintroduce them to strength training. And we're going to do that from a low intensity to a medium intensity to higher intensities over the course of most likely 6 to 8 weeks. Okay. And that sounds like a long time, but if you get a soft tissue injury, in that ramping up phase again, it's going to stick with you for 3 months, 6 months, a year, maybe more. So we want to really make sure we don't have that happen. We want to get all of the connective tissue and the muscles in the body and the nervous system as well, you know, back up to speed where they were when they left off. So for people like you, Siki, we'll talk about them now. You've been doing body weight training. Do you have any bands or dumbbells or anything, or it's just body weight only?
I have a kettlebell too, so I tend to just, you know, use that.
Okay, so for people that are doing things, and this is on your own, again, if you're with us in the program, we're going to manage this for you. But if you're on your own and you don't want to get back into training, hold on, Jack. So what we're covering now is people that have body weight workouts that they've been doing and some equipment at home. So people that have some equipment at home, bands, kettlebells, dumbbells, maybe like Jackie, makeshift barbells where she puts some concrete blocks, some pails and some steel bars and stuff from Home Depot, and she's doing some training. We want to make sure that we give you an amount of time too to acclimate back into the traditional volume that you had. If you run before you can walk, you're going to get hurt. You're going to fall down, right? So we want to make sure that you're walking first, then moving around a little quicker before we get you running and then sprinting. That's a metaphor, obviously. So what we'd like to see you do is take a time period of, you know, maybe 4 to 8 weeks, just like a person that has not been lifting, and ramp your training back up a little bit. I wouldn't suggest percentages right now for people, just because you may have been, like I said, a 500 or a 600 pound squatter, or for Jackie, close to a 400 pound deadlifter, right? Am I in the right ballpark?
Yeah.
And if you, what kind of weight do you have at home right now? How's the bar feel? Like 200 pounds or so?
Yeah, it's about, depending on which ones I put on. I made two different sets of weights. I did 45, and then I just filled the bucket, and it's like 82.6 pounds on either side.
Right.
The bar is like 15 pounds.
So you're probably, you know, maybe 60% of your max?
Probably, yeah. Around there.
So, you know, in your first week back, maybe you come back at a very low percentage, 50%, something like that, maybe even less, if you are used to this, because it's looking like right now, all across the country, places are going to start opening up. There are gyms opening up now. I have some friends that are opening up this week in other states, and the governor's on TV saying now he wants to let some businesses open up on the 18th. I don't believe that.
I think it's also based on if you look at the counties or whatever they're in, they have like 10 cases or whatever. Massachusetts just isn't like that. We're getting nailed. So we're going to be different, you know?
Right. Baker's going to be different. Baker's going to have different guidelines than a lot of people. So, you know, to think that we're going to be open on the 18th or any gyms in Mass are going to be open on the 18th, I think it's short-sighted. I've been saying that all along.
Yeah.
So by the time June comes around, that's going to give us, the gym's going to close down around St. Patty's Day. So say roughly second week of March, right? And then all of April, all of May. You're looking at roughly 10 weeks without training, right? With the barbell at typical intensities. So I'm hesitant to give you percentages to work off of, but, you know, you want to come back in at a slow and low pace and give yourself, like I said, 4 to 8 weeks to ramp up, depending on whether you had access to anything or not. So if you only had bands and light dumbbells or kettlebells, you're probably going to want to get closer to that 8 week period to ramp back up. And if you have been training at, you know, maybe 50-60% like Jackie, then you can go maybe closer to the 4-week, 6-week range. And again, percentages are tough to give to people because it's so individual. But I would say the first week back, don't start, or the first 2 weeks back, don't start with more than 50% of what your maxes were. And don't do a lot of volume. I would say do more, you know, singles, doubles, and triples, just to get used to the movement patterns. Because if you look at old school personal training, they used to always suggest that you'd start a people out with 3 sets of 10 or 3 sets of 15 things. And I always found that to be ridiculous, because when someone's form breaks down, it doesn't break down on the third rep. It's going to break down on the eighth or the ninth rep, depending on the load, right? So when you have a raw beginner or somebody that hasn't been training, they're more likely to have form and technique breakdowns on the higher end of the rep scheme than they are on the lower one. So if you keep your sets low and you take the typical mindset out where lower reps equals higher weight and higher reps equals lower weight, that's a traditional thought process with training, right? If you just take that out and you just do single, double, or triple reps and maybe do a few more sets. So, you know, if we're doing an intensity block, we might be doing 3 sets of 3 at a high percentage. But for an acclimation block like this to get your form and technique back for lifters, maybe we're going to do 6 or 8 sets of 1, 2, or 3 reps at 50%. And the next week, maybe 55 and 60, depending on how you tolerate it. And what people are going to do is they're going to get antsy and they're going to want to try to jump up like teenage boys in the weight room unsupervised. Everybody maxes, right, Brian? I mean, that's what we did. I don't know if teenage girls did it at your school, Jackie, but I know every teenage boy threw a max on. If we think,
I'm almost 40 and I still do it. Sometimes.
And you still do it, right? Yeah, you turn everything into a 10, bro. But, you know, so if we think about using that time frame in what I would call a reconstruction phase and keeping the reps low and the sets higher, even though the percentage is low, your technique is going to improve, you know? And there'll be people that argue with me and say technique flaws aren't going to come into place until you see higher reps. But in somebody that's detrained, it doesn't matter, right? We're trying to build up strength in the connective tissue, you know, regrooving those neurological patterns into the lifts and things like that. So if we slowly ramp up our percentage over anywhere from 4 to 8 weeks before we get back to max, then we're going to be doing pretty well. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yep.
Right. So now we move on to somebody like Brian. Brian has a full home gym, and he has been training at the frequency, intensity, and duration that we've recommended in the program. And how's that going for you, Brian?
Absolutely fine. Only problem is I find lifting by myself, it tends to take a little bit longer than if I'm in the gym, just because I'm putzing around. I may listen to a song a little bit more or something like that, and then jump in, where there's a certain flow to the being in the gym where I can bang it out in like an hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes.
Right.
But now it's taking me a little over two.
Right. Different entity when you're in the room with other people.
Yeah, totally.
So totally. For people like Brian and all the people watching that have been training, it's a good idea if you don't have a coach, maybe get one for that time period. And, you know, if you can't afford it, that's something else. But think about keeping your intensities a little bit lower, because if you are getting back into the gym, think about mentally putting a leash on yourself, because even if you have been training at home and you may not have the same amount of weight that you would have access to in the gym, you're going to want to jump in, most people, and start banging right away. And that's probably not the best idea. So if you have been training at home and you follow a program where you're just doing what you normally do and you have full access to the amount of weights that you would normally use in the gym, you probably don't need to make any changes at all. You could probably just get right back at it. But what I've discussed with countless people during this time frame is that they just don't have enough weights at home. So they're using less weights and doing things to, you know, increase the intensity and increase the difficulty of the exercise, like we discussed, such as tempos or, you know, doing a little bit more volume. If that's the case for you, you're going to want to maybe spend 3 to 5 weeks, you know, and that's just a rough guess, because like I said, everything is individual with people. Some people are going to come back quickly. Some people might take a little bit more time to come back. So we want to kind of stretch it. And I would say err on the side of maybe reconstructing for a week or two too long before you jump back into really hardcore training, because it's not going to do any harm. Okay. If the workout is easier with those lighter weights, rest less, right? Take your accessory work and maybe double it up. So do two exercises at the same time if you're not on a program and you want to try to make the exercise a little more intense. There's lots of things that you can do. Anybody have questions on that?
You're good. Keep going.
No, I think it's a little easier for us because we do have your years of experience behind it.
Mistakes.
What?
My years of mistakes.
Yeah, exactly. Because if I didn't have you guys or go to the gym or whatever, I would be making the same mistake and just jumping right in.
Yeah.
But follow the program, stupid. Right?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I've made that mistake a few times over the years. It wasn't a pandemic, but it was coming back off of surgeries or muscle tears, and specifically surgeries, off of knee surgeries. And I had some abdominal surgery. With the knee surgeries, the first two, I came back way too fast because things were moving pretty good. And like an asshole, I'd get a cortisone shot. And instead of letting the cortisone, I got a cortisone shot because the doctor wanted it to help the healing. But when you get that, you don't feel the pain.
Right.
So instead of listening to the doctor and him saying, you know, keep it low, I'd be like, fuck that. Doesn't hurt. I'm loading it up, you know, and then I do some more damage and, you know, whatever. Right. So coming from the abdominal surgery, I did follow my own advice and I came back a little bit slower than I should have. I actually did 5-3-1, which is a great program, but it just doesn't fit my mindset. It's a little too slow pace for me, coming from a conjugate West Side style background where you're hitting the mats all the time. That 5-3-1 program was exactly what I needed at that time. So coming back from that abdominal surgery where I was on the 5-3-1 program, I used a very low training max. I think it was 70%. So that put my actual training max at around 60% for the first month. So that allowed me to recover and heal properly. And that kind of fills in with the guidelines that I'm giving you guys in this conversation. It's not exactly the same, but it's pretty close, you know? So what I would do with that is I would bump the training max up a little bit every 2 to 3 weeks. So after about 8 weeks, I was up at that 90% training max. And I rushed it a little bit, but it seemed to work out fine. Had I done the things that I had always done and just jumped right back into training, I would have had substantially longer recovery time. So that's kind of what I want to get into you guys, is that if you rush back into training, once the gym opens. And this is mostly for the viewers. It's not for the people here because Jackie doesn't follow our program, but she is in the gym. And if I see her doing something dumb, I'm going to yell at her, right? But the other three people on the call with us now are in the program, so they won't have to worry about these things. But for the viewers watching this, to really want to stress to you that you give it some time. No harm is going to come to you from training at a little bit lower intensity for a couple of weeks to maybe 2 months, and allowing your body to get used to not being on the couch Netflix binging. And if I imagine most of the viewers aren't doing what we see a lot of people doing, your day drinking and eating like crap. But maybe there are some people here that are doing that. If that's the case, you want to take a little bit longer before you jump back into a higher intensity training. So I don't know if I wrapped that up for you guys well. Did it make sense? Does it need more explanation?
You're good.
Cool. That was a quick, thanks for watching. And we'll be back next week with some more information for you right here at EliteFTS.com and TPSMethods.com.